Good morning.
Good morning.
It is good to see all of you this wonderful Sunday morning. This is the first Sunday in Advent, and we are so pleased to have you with us today. If you will notice the church, you couldn't help but notice that the church is decorated so pretty, the sanctuary is. We want to thank the folks who were here yesterday who helped make that happen. It's just a glorious way to celebrate the Christmas season. There are some announcements that I want to go ahead and make this morning. Excuse me. First of all, folks who are streaming with us today, if you would go ahead and get the elements ready for communion today. The elements here, the bread and the juice, they are symbolic. And so if there's anything in your home that you can use to help you celebrate communion, it may be bread, it may be juice, it could be any kind of something that you would take into your body, into your mouth. Please go ahead and get that ready now. We want to thank you for supporting the First Sunday Collection, for sharing and caring. We want to give a big thank you to the Fellowship Committee for all their efforts for the Harvest Home Dinner and to the volunteers who assisted with cleanup. Special thanks here to Jim and Phyllis March, MG and Kim Moran, Marinelle Stringer for preparing the turkeys and other goodies. Thanks also goes out to all who brought covered dishes. Now, we're going to have poinsettias decorate the sanctuary here as we do each year. If you would like to place a plant in honor or memory of a loved one, please complete the order form and turn it in along with the money by Wednesday, December the 11th. Wednesday, December the 11th is the cutoff date on that. And then they will be placed in the sanctuary on the 15th. And then if you would wait until Christmas Eve after the service we have there to pick them up and take them home at that point at the Christmas Eve service. So have them ready to go here on the 15th of December. And then after the Christmas Eve service, you'll be able to pick them up. Music Sunday is going to be held on December the 8th. It's going to be at our regular 10 a.m. worship service, and we will be singing Christmas carols, and so we want you to come out for that Sunday. There's a number of hymns that we will be singing. If you have one in particular that's a Christmas carol that you would like to mention to me, please do so, and I will do my very best to incorporate it. But we're going to be singing a number of Christmas carols that Sunday, and what we'll be doing is we will be singing the first and second verse of each Christmas hymn. Now, let me go ahead and mention to you that we will in all likelihood be singing these hymns once again during the Christmas season. But we're going to sing verses 1 and 2 next week, and then we will probably have them later on during the Christmas season, because there are like five or six Sundays in the Christmas season, and we will have ample time to sing them all. Presbyterian Women, December luncheon will be at the Fort Walton Beach Yacht Club on Tuesday, December the 17th at 11:30 a.m. That's when they're doing the Dirty Santa gift exchange. This year, the Angel Trees will be donated to families at Fresh Start. Fresh Start is a nonprofit organization serving local homeless families. You have 2 weeks to get the gifts back, if you will remember that. 2 weeks to get the gifts back. Also want to mention that the alternative gift catalogs are in the Narthex. Those are both local and international. The other thing I want to mention to you that I'm not sure it made in our announcements, I don't think it did, is that we do have the Advent booklets ready for you to go. They are in the Narthex. They begin with December the 1st. They end with Christmas Eve, the 24th. And so it's a great way for you to do a daily devotional. And I would recommend that you pick one up for your reading and for your enrichment. Now, I'm trying to think here. Okay, there's a number of thank you guys. I'm done on that. I've got some prompts here that I want to share with you that's going to help you worship today. First of all, if you will look at your worship bulletin with me, Okay, you will notice that when we have the call to worship, we have print there that is in regular print, and then we have print that is in bold print. That bold print, as you know, is when the congregation responds. So you do that every time. It's under the prayer of confession also. In the declaration of forgiveness, what's different there is that I will be doing the first part of the declaration of forgiveness, and then you will respond, in Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. If you see there, that is in bold, so that's how you will respond, okay? If you will keep on going down in the worship bulletin, toward the bottom of the second page there, the hymn number 88 is O Come, O Come, Emmanuel. Okay, that hymn has 7 verses to it. We will still be singing here today when the service should be older if we sing 7 verses. So we're going to sing 4 verses of this hymn, okay? 4 verses of O Come, Emmanuel. All right, then, if you will look at with me, please, to the third panel of the worship bulletin. What we're doing there is we have the invitation to the sacrament of the Lord's Supper, invitation to the table. You do that responsibly here, where I say, the Lord be with you, and then you say, and also with you. Then we're going to have the prayers of the people and the Lord's Prayer. And what will happen is when the leader prays, when I pray, Emmanuel, come, please respond with, O come and heal us. I will make it very, very clear. And when it's time for me to say, Emmanuel, come, so that I will emphasize it so that you will know to respond, O come and heal us. Now, I've given you a lot of directions this morning. Folks, what I'm trying to do with these, I don't even want to say changes, it's just to enrich our worship some by your participation in the worship service also. So that is what is going on there. I'm trying to think if there's anything else here. I don't believe there is anything else. I've hit at a lot of points here. I do want to, before I have the opening prayer today, I do want to mention, and I will introduce them again, but we're so glad to have members of the Nix family do our lighting of the Advent candle today. And that is Teresa, Nancy, and Abigail Nix. And so now is not the time, guys. I'm going to have the opening prayer, but I want to make sure that Abby got her due in here because her name was not in here. So Abby, thank you for doing this today and being a part of this. Let's bow our heads for the opening prayer, if we could, please. God of darkness, in these days marked by cold air and growing night, gather us in your place of waiting. Remind us that the dark is not empty. Show us where new life is being formed. Reveal to us the fertile grounds of our waiting, that we might bear witness to your embodiment among us, both now and in the days to come. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen. It is now time for the lighting of the Advent candle. I'm going to call Abigail Nix forward, Teresa Nix, and Nancy Hillers, please.
This is the first Sunday of Advent. We mark it by lighting a candle. 3 of these 5 Advent candles are purple. Purple is the color of penitence, preparation, and royalty. The candle we light today is the candle of hope. The Hebrew people hoped that God would deliver them from slavery. God honored their hope and sent Moses. After Moses had died, they hoped for a leader to take them to the promised land. God sent Joshua. When they were exiled to Babylon, they hoped that they would return home. God sent Ezekiel to encourage them. Mary hoped that her child would become someone special, just as the angel had said. His name was
Jesus.
Jesus. When he grew up, he called us to a commitment to God, which beams for the gift of hope. Paul said three things last forever. They are faith, hope, and love. For those of us who hope, there is a future full of wonderful surprises. Let us pray. Gracious God, may we never lose our hope in you, who were sent us the light of the world, Jesus. Amen.
As you are able, would you please stand for the call to worship? The days are coming, your salvation is nearing.
Teach us your paths as we wait on your coming promise.
The heavens are speaking, your kingdom is arriving.
Strengthen our hearts as we wait on your coming promise.
The world is turning. New life is appealing.
Keep us alert as we wait on your coming promise.
We worship you with waiting hearts this day.
Fill us with hope in this season. Amen.
In this season, so many voices wish to claim our attention, our time, our dollars. In his worship service, one voice, Jesus Christ, claims our whole lives, soul, body, heart, and mind. In humility, let us confess our faults to the voice who proclaims forgiveness. Let us together pray the prayer of confession, followed by a time of quiet meditation. Let us pray. Coming Christ, you may not find us as you hoped. We looked away from the signs we do not wish to see. We've stopped listening to distress we do not wish to hear. We are numb in convenience truth. Keep us alert, O God, to the needs of our neighbors. Revive our hearts laden with compassion, fatigue. Sharpen our minds clouded by worries.
Sober our lives addicted to privilege. Show us signs of your coming, that we stand in before you, the Messiah, in whose name we pray. Amen.
As sure as the fig tree blossoms, so sure is the salvation of God, poured out for the world in Jesus Christ our Lord. Believe the good news. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Please be seated. All right, I am going to have a time for young disciples today. Abby, we have missed you, girl. I understand that you have been doing Irish dance. Is that correct? Excellent. Come on up here with me, okay? It is so good to see you. We have missed you. It seems like you've grown a foot since I last saw you. You know, you just look great. Come on over here. We're gonna look at the manger scene here and everything. And we do this every year, and we look at the different animals that are there. And is there one in particular that you liked here, or two or three, or is there one that you like here, or do you know? You don't know. That's okay. I want to tell you that this here is a camel. Do you recognize a camel? Yeah, you know what a camel is. And here's another camel, too. I want to tell you that one time, my wife and I, Mary Nell, when we were in Egypt, we rode these big animals, these camels. And they are just huge. And so look at all the different animals out here. There's a camel, there's a donkey, there's cattle, there's sheep in here, there's some goats in here. There's a goat there, so you know, everybody's gathered around here. And there is Mary and Joseph, okay? So there's only one person that's meant. Oh, here's the wise men here too, okay? Three wise men. There's only one person that's missing in here. And I'm not going to put pressure on you to see if you know who it is, but do you have any idea who's missing? Jesus is missing, exactly. So the reason Jesus is missing is because we are waiting for Jesus to come. Jesus has not come as a baby yet. And when Jesus does come on Christmas Eve, we're going to go ahead and put that baby out here, okay? So what we do right now is we wait for the baby Jesus to come. I'm going to put this maybe in a term that would be helpful for us to understand. We wait for the baby Jesus to come, but you know what? We're also waiting for Santa Claus to come. And I'm excited about Santa Claus coming because I know I'm going to get some really cool gifts, you know. But right now, see, we are waiting for the baby Jesus to come. And so we anticipate his coming. We are looking forward to it. And we hope that when he comes, that we will be able to say Jesus Christ has been born, and he's born as a baby. And isn't it cool that he was born as a baby and not as a full-grown adult? I mean, babies are real helpless and everything. You know, you have babies in your family, don't you? Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do. Yeah, you do. So anyhow, let's me and you. You mind taking my hand here? Is that okay? Let's me and you have a prayer. And everybody's going to repeat the prayer after me out here. And so let's pray together, okay? Dear God.
Dear God.
Help us to expect the baby Jesus.
The baby Jesus.
Amen.
Amen.
Thank you. Are you going to all right, very good. You go ahead and leave then. All right. All right, Jim.
Let us pray. God of hope, you never let us go. Draw near to us in these ancient words. By your Holy Spirit, may we be filled, lifted up, and leveled as you prepare in our hearts the path of coming. Amen. Our first scripture lesson today is from the book of Joel, chapter 2, verses 21 through 27, located on page 847 of the Old Testament in your pew Bible if you'd like to follow along. Listen now for God's word in Holy Scripture. Do not fear, you animals of the field, for the pastures of the wilderness are green. The tree bears its fruit. The fig tree and the vine give their full yield. O children of Zion, be glad and rejoice in the Lord your God, for he has given the early rain for your vindication. He has poured down for your abundant rain, the early and the later rain as before. The threshing floors shall be full of grain. The vats shall overflow with wine and oil. I will repay you for the years that the swarming locust has eaten, the hopper, the destroyer, and the cutter, my great army, which I sent against you. You shall eat in plenty and be satisfied and praise the name of the Lord your God, who has dealt wondrously with you, and my people shall never again be put to shame. You shall know that I am in the midst of Israel, and that I, the Lord, am your God, and there is no other. And my people shall never again be put to shame. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our second scripture lesson today comes from the book of Acts in the New Testament. It is on page 120 if you would like to follow along. I'm going to read Acts 2, chapter 2, verses 41 and 42, and then I'm going to move over to chapter 4, verses 32 through 37. This is talking about the first converts. So those who welcomed his message were baptized, and that day about 3,000 persons were added. They devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching and fellowship, to the breaking of bread and the prayers. And now move on over to chapter 4, verses 32 through 37. Now the whole group of those who believed were of one heart and soul, and no one claimed private ownership of any possessions, but everything they owned was held in common. With great power the apostles gave their testimony to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus, and great grace was upon them all. There was not a needy person among them, for as many as owned lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of what was sold. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and it was distributed to each as any had need. There was a Levite, a native of Cyprus, Joseph, to whom the apostles gave the name Barnabas, which means son of encouragement. He sold a field that belonged to him, then brought the money and laid it at the apostles' feet. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
A recent novel by Ann Tyler tells of a man named Ezra who ran a restaurant. All his life long, all Ezra's life long, feeding people was his way of caring for them. He made friends with Mrs. Scarlatti. She owned Scarlatti's restaurant. Ezra worked for Mrs. Scarlatti, and one day she turned the business over to him. Ezra tried different formats and menus, and one day this idea came to him. He would cook what people felt homesick for. Tacos like those vendors' carts in California, which the Hispanic people were always pining for. And that wonderful vinegary North Carolina barbecue that Todd Duckett had to have brought in by his mother several times a year in cardboard cups. He would call it the Homesick Restaurant. Thus, the title of the novel, Dinner at the Homesick Restaurant. Now, let's talk about food right quick here, just a little bit. Let me ask you, what kind of food do you get homesick for? When Alexander Julian, the fashion designer of the Colors label, a North Carolina native, designed the new uniforms for the Charlotte basketball team, he was paid in monthly shipments of North Carolina barbecue. Now, I happen to know a few transplanted Texans here in Fort Walton who almost drink hot salsa sauce when they eat Mexican food. What kind of food are you homesick for? A regional dish? A dish you could only get at home? Are your taste buds beginning to awaken here as I talk about all this? Are your memories beginning to awaken? Food and memories, they do go together, don't they? And food is more than just food. Folks, the food we are homesick for has to do more than just taste. It has to do with place and time and the experience of joy, comfort, or love. It tastes like home. When we were growing up and when we were feeling ill, our mothers may have served us a special kind of soup. So now when we're feeling low and weak, we hunger for that soup and the hands that served it to us. So what was your favorite meal at home growing up? What was your favorite meal? In our family, on the birthday of each family member, the one whose birthday it was got to pick what Mary Nell would cook that evening, their favorite meal, or if that wasn't possible, they would decide where we would eat out and have our meal. So what did or what do you cook for your son or your daughter when they came home after being gone for a while? What did you use to hope to eat when you went home? Now, we may be remembering our favorite cook's cooking by now. For me, it was at my in-law's house, Charlie and Sadie Potter's house, that I remember most. At their house, I'd wake up early to the smell of country ham frying in the pan. And I'd walk into the kitchen greeted by eggs, grits, biscuits, country ham, of course, and red-eye gravy to pour it over it all. Just thinking about it raises my cholesterol. A woman once told me of her grandmother, whose home was the most home she had ever known as an adult. It was her grandmother's mashed potatoes she was most homesick for, now that her grandmother had died. Every time she went home, she said, her grandmother fixed mashed potatoes. And it wasn't just the potatoes, the taste of the potatoes that she was homesick for, though the taste was wonderful enough. But the going to her grandmother's home and working alongside her grandmother in the kitchen, boiling, slicing, mashing the potatoes, preparing them for the table. That was when you would put them in your mouth, they tasted like home. Love and friendship and comfort and somebody who was there for you when you needed them. That was home. So let me ask you this. What kind of food are you homesick for? It has occurred to me that the communion table here is a kind of homesick restaurant. It's a place where we find what we're most homesick for. It's the place where homesick people come to the communion table. Sometimes we don't even know that we are homesick until we get here, and suddenly our appetite returns. Funny, when we're homesick, when we're really homesick, we don't ever feel like eating until we get home. And when our legs are finally under that familiar table, we feel like we could eat forever. Now, on to our Acts lesson here from the New Testament. The picture that we get of the early church in Acts tells what people found when they met together around Christ's table, things that they had hungered for all their lives. First, they were fed as they devoted themselves to the apostles' teaching. We need to hear words from beyond our own fragile and confused hearts and minds. The scriptures of the Old and New Testaments work as a compass to guide us through uncharted seas, stormy seas. Isn't our deepest hunger then, our most intense homesickness, to be connected up with God? To find that place of peace where what God wants and what we want are the same? Sturdy guidance, tender mercy, light in the darkness, care for our souls, a song in the night is what we will find as we devote ourselves to the apostles' teaching. Folks, we are also homesick for one another, for communion and the community of God. God did not make us to be alone, but to live in communion with each other. The early church devoted itself to fellowship. Fellowship, community, is not an instant reality. We have to be committed to fellowship. Scripture says they partook of food with glad and generous hearts. What a picture of the gift of community. They gathered around the Lord's table and they prayed together. They ate food together with glad and generous hearts. Folks, I believe that we are all homesick for that experience. Sitting with people who we love and who love us, hearts filled with gladness, and hearts that want to give and give and give and give. They shared everything, the text says, everything. Everything was shared in common, even possessions. When we share our possessions, we've shared our very lives. Leo Bebb, the odd evangelist in Frederick Buechner's novel, Love Feast, threw a Thanksgiving meal and invited everybody in the town who could come. As they assembled, he said, "The kingdom of heaven is like a great feast, a love feast where no one is a stranger." And then he said, we all got secrets, hurtful things, long ago things. We're all scared and we're all lonesome, but most of the time we keep it hid. It's like every one of us has lost his way so bad we don't even know which way is home anymore. Only we are ashamed to ask. You know what would happen if we would own up and say that we're lost and we're sick? Why, what would happen is we'd find our home, we'd find out that home is each other. We would find out home is Jesus loves me, lost or found, or any which way. Home is each other. It may be the best home or the most home we've ever experienced. In Tyler's novel, Ezra kept trying to get his family together for a meal in his restaurant. They never made it through a meal without getting into a fight. Somebody stomping out, everything falling apart. One time they didn't even make it through the appetizer. Jesus says that the best home of all is not the one behind us, but the one we can taste, glimpse, touch here and now around the table of our Lord. So what are we hungry for? Are we hungry for justice? Justice we can taste here, though it's not perfect. But more than ever before and more to come. Mercy? Mercy is here too, like we have never imagined. And peace, well-being in the community and with God and inside our own skin, it is here too. Home is most of all, though, meeting Jesus. Jesus loving us, lost, found, or any which way. That was the experience of the disciples. As they gathered around the table and broke bread, they experienced the presence of Jesus. And so we meet Jesus here at the Homesick restaurant, and he is the one we hunger for most of all. There is forgiveness and there is welcome here. There's a Savior here around this table who understands everything because there is nothing human he has not experienced. He's experienced every human push and pull, every delight and every despair, every broken heart and every heart on fire. And this Savior is not sitting there with his arms crossed, just waiting to see if we're smart enough, if we're hungry enough to come. He is the shepherd leaving the 99 safe ones and going after the one that is lost. So he's the woman who is turning the house upside down and looking for her cherished coin. He's the father running down the driveway, down the street to greet his son home, whom he thought was lost. He is the king throwing a banquet and sending his servants to bring in everybody and anybody they can. Folks, when we come to this table, we meet Jesus Christ. I like the way that my friend George Buttrick referred to Jesus. Here's what he said. Surprise of mercy, outgoing gladness, rescue, healing, and life. Jesus is the one we are most homesick for because it was through him, for him, and in him that we were made. When we come home to Jesus, we finally come home to ourselves. We find ourselves saying, so that's who I am. Jesus is the one that we meet at the Homesick restaurant. He takes an apron and he waits on every table. Ours too. What would you like, he asks. We stammer and we ask for a little more time. We're not always sure what we want, what we're homesick for. But Jesus is patient. We ask, escargot? What is escargot? And he says, I don't think that's what you're looking for. Have you tried our roast beef and mashed potatoes? That sounds very good, we say, and smile with sudden recognition. We're nervous about the price, and we look over to the right-hand column, the place where the prices are. And to our shock, we see no prices. You know that you're in trouble when the prices aren't even printed. But Jesus sees our anxiety and he says, don't worry. Don't worry. It is on the house. It is on the house. Welcome home. Welcome home. Amen. Our affirmation of faith is printed in our bulletin. Let us stand and say what we believe together. Out of Israel, God in due time raised up Jesus. His faith and obedience were the response of the perfect child of God. He was the fulfillment of God's promise to Israel, the beginning of the new creation, and the pioneer of the new humanity. He gave history its meaning and direction and called the church to be his servant for the reconciliation of the world. Amen. Please be seated. Today we invite you to profess Jesus Christ as your Lord and your Savior. We also invite you to unite with us here in membership at First Presbyterian Church. If you are interested in discipleship or membership, please see me after the service of worship today. Rejoicing in the Lord always. We give thanks for the word made flesh. With grateful hearts, let us offer our whole selves to God. Thank you. Let us pray. O God, most high, receive the gifts of our lives as an offering of gratitude for your grace. Overshadow us with your Holy Spirit, and let it be with us according to your word. For nothing is impossible with you. Amen. Please be seated. The Lord's table. Our Savior invites those who trust in him to share in this great feast that he has prepared for us. Come unto me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you rest. According to Luke, when our risen Lord was at table with his disciples, he took the bread, he blessed it, he broke it, and he gave it to them. And their eyes were opened, and they recognized him. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Let us pray. Trusting in the steadfast love of the Lord, let us pray for the fulfillment of God's promises. We pray today for the world. Teach us to interpret the signs around us, warnings of disaster and destruction. Bring peace and healing to this planet. Emmanuel, come. Oh, come and heal us. We pray for this community. Bless our houses and bless our neighbors. Bless our neighborhoods with your justice and righteousness so that all may live in safety without fear. Emmanuel, come. Oh, come and heal us. We pray for loved ones. Remember those who lift their souls to you. Surround them with your steadfast love. Oh, come and heal us. Come quickly, Emmanuel, in power and glory to establish your realm of justice and peace, and make us ready on the day of redemption to stand before you, our Savior and our Lord. We pray all this in the name of Jesus, who taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. The Lord Jesus, on the night of his arrest, took bread. And after giving thanks to God, he broke it and he said, "This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant sealed in my blood, shed for the forgiveness of sins." Whenever you drink it, do this remembering me. For every time you eat of this bread and you drink of this cup, you proclaim the death of our Lord until he comes again. The body of Christ broken for you, the blood of Christ shed for you. And now would the people please come forward. Let us pray. God, our provider, we rejoice that you satisfy our needs. By your presence in this meal, you have fed us and strengthened us. In this waiting season of Advent, fill us with hopeful expectation. We may see the signs of your kingdom all around us and rejoice in your coming salvation and glory. Amen. And now may the peace of God, which passes all our understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I say rejoice. The Lord is near. Amen.